Here they come. Dave Smith. Yeah, those work. And Luis J. Gomez. From Legion of Skanks.
The Legion of Skank.
Yeah.
The Legion isn't here.
The Legion of Skies here.
Yeah, well, come on. If of Skanks is fine. We can give Jay his own word.
He's the Legion.
He's a big boy.
He's a big Legion.
How come he's still coming in?
Well, he said he wouldn't do the show without Opie, so.
Oh.
I've been told I put the of in Legion of Skanks.
Yeah, that would make sense, actually.
He doesn't like getting up in the morning?
No. He legitimately hit me up at 7 this morning and was like, dude, I'm sick. I'm like, I don't know if he's puking or shitting or both or...
Hungover?
I don't know. I don't think he's hungover. He just said he's sick. He legitimately said he's bummed, though, and he wanted to be here, and he'll definitely do it again in the future, so.
Yeah, for sure.
Adrian, you thought it was because of... Why, you thought because he didn't come in the morning before?
Me? No, I was guessing.
Oh, you just guessed. Okay, that's a guess.
What was Adrian's guess? Because I take anything somebody in a turkey costume.
Yeah. He thought maybe Jay was mad.
Dude, the really hilarious thing about making someone wear a turkey costume at work like that is just when they forget they're in a turkey costume,
right,
and give you a serious... Like, he just comes and he goes, they're ready for you. And you're like,
well, that's the plan. There's no sort of like, whoa, watch our guy in a turkey outfit do crazy Thanksgiving stunts. Like... No, he's just going to wear that and do his job.
The only thing that would be better is if he was fired today for something. and he had to go in that fucking douchey outfit.
I love that's also 99.9% of the people that consume this show do it through audio means only. So there's no reason for
this. There's no reason. No, we're going to ignore him now.
They've been told several times that he's in a chicken outfit, I imagine.
I promise you. He's dressed as poultry. I assure you, it's a man in a bird outfit. It's the craziest goddamn thing you've ever seen.
It's really nuts around here.
Yeah, I mean...
he's a quail.
We get a little crazy before the holidays.
Yeah,
guys,
we sure do. We get the sound effects. Oh my god, fucking
yeah, it's a little nuts.
Oh, amazing! What a show.
It's a little nuts
what a
in
show.
Here, man.
Yeah, having the Legion of Skanks on. It's like, let's make silly visual puns for the holidays.
So, are you guys doing a big Thanksgiving show? Or are you just doing your show?
We're just doing our show. Yeah. We were gonna do like a thing, but every time we have an idea for a show, it falls apart. Sometimes we do it, but it'll always be put together like last minute. Like,
right.
You just said that, and I'm kind of getting motivated. I'm like, nah, dude, we should fucking do a Thanksgiving
show.
Well,
see, that's your problem. Like, you're a motivated guy, and you always want to be doing something.
Yeah.
And, like, you always feel like you have to do something different or something special or something. Sometimes it's okay to just do the show. You could just do the show and just do a good show.
But when you just said that, it sounded so boring that I literally want to go to sleep.
No, I know what it is. It's the fear of falling through the cracks. I get it. It's doing 50 different things and never saying no to anything because you're like, I'm going to be irrelevant if I don't do any. I get it. I always keep busy because I am literally hanging on by a thread.
I have to be in front of people. I have to remind people that I exist.
Well, yeah, as Norton saying it, I'm just... Like, yeah, that's the story of your career. You just do like 1,000 different things.
Always doing them. But that's what it is. People like your work ethic. I'm like, no, I'm terrified.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm hanging on by a thread.
It's kind of because when you work, you're almost like kind of self-promoting at the same time. If I'm doing something and I'm promoting this thing that I'm doing, I'm also letting people know that I have shit going on at the exact same time. You know what I'm saying? So it's almost like while you're working, you're actually promoting yourself.
Right. And you don't ever want to be like, no, this is... This isn't all I do.
Yeah.
No. I got a whole bunch of other stuff going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because you start to like want the audience to know too. Like, just so you guys know, it's not like I just do this show and then leave and go home and just scratch my balls. It's like I'm working so hard and blah blah. No, we don't care. We just want to hear a good show.
Yeah.
You know.
But
it's unhealthy. It's not.
Now
good.
We need some sort of good food. We need some sort of turkey costume or some sort of like things. We
you
need
can't
maybe
just do good radio anymore. You gotta have a guy in a turkey costume.
Yeah. We can bring in a bunch of Dominicans and have them dress as American Indians and have a bunch of white guys come in and slay them on stage as kind of like an opening passion play for Legion of Skanks.
In the middle?
Yes.
The little turkey boy in the middle.
So you guys are jealous. That you walk in and you see we've got a turkey boy.
A whole production team behind us.
Yeah, I mean,
I've always
loved
pageantry.
Yeah.
And when you see it up live, it's impressive.
You guys motivated me now. Now you're bringing the best out of me. I like it. I walk in here. By the way, I'm in a great mood this morning. I don't really wake up this early and broadcast, but I will tell you right now, this is fucking nice.
Why are you in a great mood?
Any excuse to not hang with Jay. Is really nice.
Jay didn't show up.
Yeah, he's now, there's no strife right between the three of you?
No, not at all. Yeah.
I mean, we're all brothers, so we've all like fought a lot, but we're all.
Who gives a shit? Why would we care that he would start a radio show with the best guest that we have on our podcast out of nowhere? But anyway,
that's totally cool.
But what
I think is in the
morning, invited you guys to do it with him, right?
What? What, the...
The radio show with your best guest?
Oh, yeah, no, we chose not to take a weekly salary coming in for all the work that's right.
Yeah, no, they wanted it to be... The bonfire originally was all of us, and we said, you know what? You guys do it.
Right. Yeah, I would assume that Jay was like, well, why don't, the show I'm already doing is great, and we could do it with Soder. Why don't we just go do that, and that we could all do it?
He did that, and you guys were like, no.
When
Dan would come into that room and sit down with us... His ass would hit the seat, and it was like we would take our audience on a magical journey.
Right.
And it was like Jay saw that, and he was like, dude, we got to capture that, bottle it.
Without some of the dead weight.
By the way, you know what? Soder.
We got to trim the fat.
Dude, Soder came on Legion of Skanks, and we were joking around about this, and Soder goes, no, dude, it's like Wu-Tang Clan, and I'm like Method Man. And then you were like, half of Wu-Tang is dead, dude. Like, it didn't work out well for any of them.
That's right.
Method Man and Redman went on to become movie stars, and, like, ODB's dead. Right. I don't know. But anyway, that was his example to calm me down.
That's right.
Because, like, Method Man is the one household name, by the way, in Wu-Tang. Like, people who are not hip-hop... Why does he get to be Method Man? He's not even.
No, he's Red Man.
Oh, he.
Jay's Method
and
Man.
And Jay gets. And who are you guys?
Well, we're not even the other seven guys.
Lewis is
guys...
like the Jizza.
You're the Jizza.
And you're Jerry. He's the Wu-Tang guy that no one knew.
Yeah, I'm the guy that, like, you know how you go out and people will be like, oh, yeah, we're Wu-Tang affiliated? I'm one of those. I'm like a gang member, part time rapper.
You're the guy who cut off his dick and jumped out the window and said, I'm in Wu-Tang.
Oh, God. Yes. I did Jay's crowd work show, which was fun.
Yeah.
It's weird doing all crowd. Like, you get so used to. I love doing crowd work, but I do it in the middle of something. Like, when I feel like doing it. But when you go up and just do it with no material, it's a weird thing to just start talking to people.
It's cool because I did that show last season, and it's being recorded, and you can't use any material, which puts a comic. And even like you said, even if you do that sometimes, it's just a set, and you have your jokes in between. So it's nice to put you on the spot to be like, this is going to be recorded, and you can't use any crutches at all.
Well, there's times where, like, when you're talking to people, where you're like, I don't even want to ask this guy a question. I don't give a fuck about him. Sometimes you use it to segue into something else.
Yeah.
You know, it's called being a lazy writer. Like, I just want to segue from relationships into fucking, you know, whatever, Somalia. So I'm like, I'll find some skinny black guy. Whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I think the it's weird because it's almost easy. When if I'm doing a set, I go, I can always rely on crowd work. If the jokes aren't going well, I'll just go to crowd work and get it. You know, you get a cheap, easy laugh. It's kind of easy to do crowd work. But then when you're just doing crowd work and you can't rely on your jokes, it flips it in a weird way, and you kind of put a spotlight on it. It's a very you start to have a lot of respect for somebody like Jay or somebody like I know Todd Barry just did that tour and did that album.
Voss does a lot of that stuff.
You know, it's pretty intimidating when you don't have the jokes that you know work. But I think the instinct is to always go to the generic, where are you from? What do you do for a living? Yeah. And Jay taught me a while ago. And Jay, look, truthfully, we're busting Jay's balls, but he's a fucking master of the craft of comedy. He's one of the most brilliant comics. He's really funny. And he had gave me great advice on crowd work. He was like, dude, you don't have to go where you're from, you know, what do you do for a living? Just ask them something very specific, you know? I mean, he always goes dirty, so he'll be like,
ask them something very specific. And Jay's example is always like, does your girl shave her pussy hair or something?
But, I mean, if you kind of, like, you're going to always go to a unique way. So instead of saying, where are you from, I could say to you, it's like, oh, what would you have this morning for breakfast? You know, like, nobody else is doing a crowd work show is going to kind of start from that
angle. Wow,
what
a fascinating question. Hey, Jim, I want to know the actual answer to that, man.
I'll be very honest with you. No, that's always dessert. You don't get your treat. You don't get your pudding unless you eat your meat.
That's right. That's right.
I had some egg whites and a little avocado and a little coffee.
That's almost gayer than semen.
Jim was telling us, wait, you know, he's got a special coming up in next month. And after he shoots his special, that's when he's going to treat himself to a cheat day where he's going to eat pizza and M&M's.
Oh,
that's right. I'm going to shit my own mouth. Headstanding.
That's right.
Yeah, with crowd work, the weird thing is it's almost like a lot of times you don't know where you want to go with it, or just keep them talking. That's an old thing in crowd work. People will eventually give you something if you just ask a couple of questions. Eventually they're going to trip up, or there's going to be something.
They'll say something stupid eventually, guaranteed, because they're nervous.
Right.
In that moment being put on the... You don't remember, like... We go on stage every night, or you're on the radio, Sam, or whatever it is, but it's like people that are put on the spot like that, they're terrified to speak in front of 150 people, 200 people.
Do you find gold mines, though, that you just don't want to get rid of? Like, because when I have like an intern or something who's specifically nervous, or like D-Bag, for instance, when D-Bag's in here and we start talking to him, I feel like I just want to keep talking to him because he just keeps coming up with stuff. Or you remember Hot Dog?
Sure.
Hot Dog, like, no matter what you would do.
Did you make him dress like a hot dog?
No. No, that was just his name. But Hot Dog, no matter what you would bring up, no matter what you would do, he would come up with the stupidest real life story or theory or whatever it was. And I would just find myself falling into hot dog traps where I would never want to get off this person.
I've had those things sometimes where you have like a, you know, sometimes you'll just talk to someone and you're not planning on getting into it long, but like you said, they're just so interesting. You're like, well, you know, you just
I'm
like,
gonna give up
like,
my show and just talk to you.
Well, you know, you're just like, you're like, oh, dude, where are you from? And you usually expect to get, and someone will be like, you know, like Iran, and then you're like, well, now we got to do a little bit more on this because that's probably an interesting story. Like, or there's just something about the dynamic. Like,
I do crowd work in real life. So when somebody tells me they're from Iran, I'll be like, yeah, dude, fucking terrorists. Guaranteed. I make everyone laugh at them. I get crowds together around them.
It's not
them.
So much doing crowd work as it is. I'm working for Trump rounding people up. Yeah. I'm just like, are you from Iran?
It's really hate speech.
That's what
it's
it
really
is.
What I like to do. You're not going to always get the gold mine, though, in the audience. Like, I mean, every show would be great if you could find a guy in a wheelchair with no arms and his mouth open. Do a half hour on that guy. But that's not always available.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, side note, happy harassment day.
It is harassment day.
Tuesday before Thanksgiving.
The Tuesday before Thanksgiving.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
One of the best Patrice bits.
The Patrice O'Neal bits, yeah. Do you, you know, when you're talking about just having to do stuff all the time and work, and Dave, you do it too. Like, you're on Fox News all the time. Like, you're just whatever. Do you guys ever get into this spot where you're like, I need to just do something good and disappear for a while? I need people to miss me. Or are you so afraid, like Jim said?
Oh, I've never even gotten
falling off the radar.
I'm more just terrified of. I feel like if I take a week off of comedy, everything I've ever done is lost.
Yeah, my career's
gone. I don't think I can, like, for 1 second not. I feel like particularly where I'm at, I feel like whatever any set that I do, any radio show I do, anything, I feel pressure to, like, it's got to be really good and let everybody know because it's just so, it feels so like radio and comedy, all of it's such a competitive game. So I've never gotten to the point where I feel like I got to leave them wanting Dave Smith a little bit.
Yeah. But,
what else do you do besides the Legion of Skanks?
I do like a, I mean, I work for Sirius, for Rush, like part time. And then I do, you know, Fox News shows and stand up and stuff.
Okay.
And your podcast.
And my podcast, Part of the Problem. So
yeah.
Like a political show.
And what do you got, Lewis? You have Legion of Skanks, you have your thing with Michael Bisping,
yeah,
which I like.
The Countdown on Sirius XM Rush 93. And, you know, that was with the middleweight champion, Michael Bisping. And then I have another podcast called Real Ass Podcast. And I run a podcast network called Gas Digital Network, which houses Legion of Skanks, David Smith's show. Also, Bruce Buffer has a show on our network, Jamie Joss.
Oh, I didn't know Bruce and Jamie were on your network. Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah.
Bruce does a good job. He's fucking, he's a good host.
Yeah, he's great.
He's great. He's a super interesting guy. He's also got like this crazy respect. He is an entrepreneur himself, but he has like a crazy respect for entrepreneurs. And like, I love that world. I watch Shark Tank like a fucking asshole.
It's the best.
I literally, Shark Tank, like it's a soap opera. I've watched every episode. I watched every episode of the Australian Shark Tank. Dragon's Den, the Canadian version of Shark Tank.
Do you watch the show After the Tank or whatever
it's
called?
No, I'm not an asshole.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Because there's no drama with
what's
that.
What's After the Tank?
They just show you, like, look, now the products are in stores.
Like, it's they go to a Starbucks with a steady cam.
That's it. It's like the stupid sharks, and they're going through Bed Bath & Beyond. Like, remember? It was on the show, and you could buy it.
That's pretty fun, though.
I'm like, this now, okay, now, I got before you were kind of doing a TV show.
Yeah.
This one's just a commercial.
What are we doing here?
Yeah, there's no...
But, man, I guarantee you that show has great ratings, because people are dumb as shit and they go, oh, the sharks, and they just keep it on.
And because every now and then there's one guy that was like, you know, I got my deal, but it just didn't work out. And you're like, yes!
I love watching their dreams come crashing. Sometimes they do the children episodes where they'll bring in children. And
I didn't know they were doing that.
They have a 12-year-old entrepreneur. Like, are you fucking crazy? Name one 12-year-old that's ever had a good idea ever.
I as I'm getting older, I hate child entrepreneurs more and more.
Yeah.
Because every successful...
Just Sam kicking down lemonade stands.
Yeah, they're making money. They take pictures. They do little movies.
No, what?
Yay.
That's not entrepreneurship.
Shirley Temple. Sure it is.
Oh, that's not business.
Yeah, the good ship lollipop. You ever see that?
No, I didn't watch that.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah, dance up and down the steps.
No. No. But it's like every single kid...
Uncle Paul, do you buy lemonade?
No, I make it into a cup. I like homemade lemonade.
Oh.
Hold this by your little tinky machine.
dressing in a little tart sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, sometimes I would break the little flusher and I'd hide it in a urinal. And I'd take the cup out when he left. Glug, 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 glug.
It's terrible. I was talking about child entrepreneurs. Not...
Yeah, me too. Give my nickel. There you go.
But every kid that's like makes money, like you always see like these like 15-year-olds that have been like, yeah, I'm making $1 million selling sneakers. All of them started with like a $200,000 thing from their dad or their mom. Like they all have rich parents.
Or
that
a small
were, like,
loan of $1 million.
Donald Trump Senior.
I was a child entrepreneur. I felt like that anyway, right? I remember
what'd you sell? You sold ass. Yeah.
I was a prostitute and I wasn't really making the money. I remember, dude, since I was a very young age, I always loved making money. I was always a kid with the lemonade stand. I was always a kid to go knocking on everyone's door and shoveling their snow or raking up their leaves. Always, right? And I would undercut the other kids. I would see them price themselves at $10 to shovel a driveway. I would price myself at $8. I was fucking thinking that way.
Like Undercutter's Pizza.
Yeah. Is that not the most Hispanic thing you've ever heard? Yeah. Your life. It was just in his impulse.
Are you out of your mind?
Yes, I'm sorry that we observe how markets work.
Observe, you mean manipulate.
So my neighbor, when I was like 8 years old, 8 or 9 I had to be, my neighbor died, right? So a buddy in the neighborhood came up to me. He's like, yo, dude, this guy died and they're throwing out all of his shit. So we should go like get some of his stuff just to have. Like there was like a dartboard and like a poster of a half-naked chick. And it was like an entire house worth of like furniture and like just trinkets and shit like
poster
that.
Poster of a half naked chick in the 90s was that had some value. Huge. Behind
oh, yeah.
It. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Huge. Okay. That was a big deal. I had that poster for years, by the way.
Yeah.
Years up until I was like 15. So we went to and grabbed all the stuff out of the garbage that he was throwing out. Me and this one kid, we moved it all over to my yard and put up signs all over the neighborhood that we're having a yard sale. This is when my mom was at work, right? We ended up, I mean, literally selling out of everything. We were kids, so 8 years old, like, you think $10 is, like, a fucking $1 million. So we sold, like, a leather, like, reclining chair for, like, $6. Like, people were just taking us. Like, adults were coming and just taking us for all of this shit. And we made, like, $150 in an afternoon. And that was it. As soon as I did that, I was like, I love making money. And I worked.
I got to start robbing people's houses.
This is not killing my neighbors.
Yeah, this is an entrepreneurship.
This isn't a heartwarming story of entrepreneurship. This is horrible.
Yeah.
You stole. This is you removing someone's inheritance.
Yeah, you stole a dead lady's stuff.
So we sold it
very undervalued.
So we pop out all his gold fillings. We sell that. And at that moment, I knew.
Yeah, we put the suitcases in this room. Your luggage will meet you at the family camp.
Yeah. This is the backstory to a Law and Order SVU character. Like this isn't the beginning of Tony Robbins. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yes. But I'm saying it. Please.
Every kid has a dead neighbor's house. You guys got to be going in their garages, finding their belongings, turning them over. You're the Gary Vee for Hispanics.
Then we rented out her pussy. Guys were climbing on and fucking her for $8.
Yeah. Shit.
Yeah, I was an entrepreneur as a child and a thief.
Fuck. No, I'm saying I ended up having this type of entrepreneurial spirit from that moment. It was like,
I think it's a lack of morals you're thinking of.
Yeah, exactly.
Like a cutthroat, like.
Yes.
Yeah, that's different.
By the way, Damon John from Shark Tank has the exact same origin story.
Yeah, I sold bootleg wrestling tapes when I was in high school. Yeah.
I love that you spent all those hours. He spent literally thousands of hours categorizing and saving wrestling stuff.
Like I used
to. And now there's that network, and all of your work is for nothing.
I mean, it was even before. Like it was just because I got obsessive. Even after.
So you threw all that stuff out?
No.
Why?
I have.
You should throw it out.
I have boxes. I won't throw it out. I have boxes of VHS tapes at my parents' house.
No, but they're not
just
it's
in the
not
closet,
necessary.
Just in stacks.
Was it you're, not that you recorded yourself? Like you bought the WWF's version.
And you used to sell them like zines, like Pro Wrestling Illustrated. Because my sister and me and myself,
I sold them
sister,
on the internet. But yeah, go ahead.
Oh, this is the internet. Okay, all right. Before there was the internet, me and my sister would buy like old WWF tapes, and like there was like these zines she would get.
Sure.
That would like come around, and we would like purchase like classic shit. VHS.
Like some of them I bought, but most of them I just tape them off pay-per-view or I tape the TV. Like literally every episode of TV, and then you just dub copies and sell them. Yeah.
I never sold them. I never had an entrepreneur spirit, but I used to tape wrestling all the time. Like, I had a library of stuff that I had just taped. Like,
we didn't have a VCR.
It got so bad that I was, and this is how you know, it was in my 20s. Like, I was already working with Jim. That's how he knows about
it. You were married.
I was married. And I was DVRing Monday Night Raw, and I hooked up a DVD recorder.
DVR technology existed, we've gone too far.
Way too far. Yeah. I hooked up a DVD recorder to my DVR, and I was taping all the episodes of TV onto DVDs. So at my parents' house, I have boxes of tapes. And somewhere in my apartment is stacks of like those CD binders just full of DVDs.
Well, why don't you just put
all of which
them all
are
together.
Now readily available.
You could probably package them all together. Okay, I know everything's readily available, but there's nerds like you that you could probably get like $80 for everything.
Well, because now like I have kind of a profile in that world, so people would be like,
"It's not just anyone's."
You know, Sam Roberts is selling bootleg wrestling tapes. Like, you guys should
probably
be aware.
What else
are
you gonna sell? Episodes of Lost or fucking things they could just grab off Netflix? What else you got for sale?
That whole game changed pretty quickly.
It did. Yeah, it sure
it was
did.
Literally, it was like 2 years before all that stuff, where people would still buy like a box set DVD for like $1,000.
Yeah,
and that literally just a couple years later, they went, "How about you could just have everything for $7?"
Yeah,
literally
yeah.
everything ever.
Right.
Yeah,
it would
necessary.
Be like this elaborate like box, and it would be. It would be big and everything, and you'd buy it and spend it. And now you can see it. They have them at Best Buy now. It's like the last vestiges of DVD technology. Like, they sell it in the slim case, and it's like four seasons, and it's $10.
Well, I have the guys that go on the subway now, they still sell them. The DVDs, they'll come and try to sell like bootleg copies of movies that are out in the theater. And I'm just like, buddy, do you not know the internet is out there? Yeah. How is your whole business model hawking DVDs right now?
Yeah.
I put myself through college selling Family Feud reruns. I had a family, I had the market cornered on Family Feud, the Dawson years. Yeah. It was a really, really big.
Did you spend a lot of time in college?
Yeah. My 3 years at Northwestern.
I'm selling VHSs of cats chasing dogs around the yard.
Oh, that's adorable.
Yeah, you just sell them internet videos?
Yes.
Soldiers being reunited with their puppies.
Yeah, I have this whole series.
On VHS.
Yeah.
No, cats chasing dogs and the DVD extras is every time that's spoiled by a car tire.
Bonus! But, I mean, all the original stuff, though, probably not with... I don't know. Probably not with DVDs. Possibly. But all the original, like, VHSs, if you have, like, collectible VHS things, there are still collectors that will buy that
there
shit.
There are, but you don't have that. You have those
wrestling
things.
No, I got those, too.
No,
I got everything.
The wrestling things are no good.
Yeah, because pro wrestling fans don't purchase collectibles.
No, meaning it's all gettable. It's like saving something. I get the attraction. Dude, I have old DVD stuff I've put on DVD, like of my old sets from the cellar, and I still save the fucking VCR, the VHS. Why?
As opposed to just having it on a DVD
or
a hard drive.
Well, I'm afraid I'll lose it. Right. Like, it's insanity.
Right.
It's like this weird, it's probably this fucking primal hunting gathering thing where you're afraid of running out in the winter, but it's so stupid. Just get rid of it.
Yeah,
shit.
That whole show, what do they call it?
Hoarders?
Yeah, hoarders.
Right. It's all the same
you're
thinking.
Hoarding. You have a psychological disorder. So.
Yeah. You're hoarding.
I can walk around my house really easily.
You can, so yeah, but...
It's not a problem.
No, but your parents can't. Your parents are swimming through VHS.
They're crazy, too, though. They're crazy, too. They have his hair hoarded from when he was a boy.
Well, that's like
they
one
do.
Thing.
Hey, you guys want to check out the first ever Royal Rumble? It's under those dead cats. you can move those over.
Yeah, behind those fucking CBS bags of human waste. Yeah, I shit into a bag and there's the Royal Rumble.
But you wouldn't say dead cats. You'd be like, I don't know. I haven't seen Phoebe in a little while. I think she's just eating her.
Dude, my favorite thing about them is they'll be
cat
like...
cat skeletons.
They're such disturbed people that they're not really... Like, half the time, they're not on board with the whole process. They're like, we're going to clean up your house. And they're like, all right. And then they're like, they have this whole work, like, force of people working for free. Just
right.
To be like, oh, we'll clean up your house. And they'll be like, here's an earring. And they're like, where's the other one? Like, they're pissed off at you for cleaning out.
I actually
can't throw that out. Those are my catalogs.
I pitched Hoarders before Hoarders existed.
To who?
It was a different show.
Okay.
It was like that. It was people who are hoarders. And what you do is you start on one end of the house and you smoke them out like bees. And then when they run out, you have something that they trip over. And you ever see the end of Apocalypto? How that fucking that spike swung into that guy's chest? That would be a great way to end every Hoarders episode, where they get smoked out like bees and then impaled. So
you saw it going a different way.
Yeah. I saw it ending with really great. Their family
it's a similar concept.
Come on out! And then they run out and they trip and that thing just fucking... puts a fucking nice spike into their chest.
Dude, I have everything. I mean, my parents had, they have no closets free, I don't think. Like everything, every old T-shirt I ever bought, everything
those
is there.
Those I get, though. Those I understand. Like, I'm a collector, so I get all that. I don't throw anything out. But the stuff that's been taped off TV that you can get, that's just freeing up space because you don't need it.
But you know what? You know what, though? You know what always catches me? I'll start that process. Like, okay, I'm going to get rid of this. And then I'll like look at one, and I'll be like, oh, wait. The original commercials are on this one.
That's kind of cool.
And it's a retro thing, and then you're like, you know what?
He makes a point.
There is something to this. This is reliving
the
experience.
How often are you watching it, though?
I mean, I'm not even at my parents' house that often. Never. I don't even, I think I might have a VCR over at my parents' house that I could hook up
to
a TV.
The commercials are kind of an attractive thing. I understand
that.
Yeah.
Well, you could probably get all those commercials on YouTube, guaranteed.
That's true.
It's a whole process, but
it's a whole process, unlike going to your parents' house with a truck and sifting through hundreds of VHS tapes.
Yeah. And then you put one in, you're like, oh, I erased the commercials on this. I forgot. I hit pause. No, it's like, you know, it's the whole process of you're watching, and if you watch it on VHS, the way you taped it off TV, then you're reliving the experience of how you watched it. The Silk Stockings commercial comes on.
While you're beating off to Sonny, you're like, wait, oh, look at that, Downey.
This is just like I used to beat off to her.
The Silk Stockings commercial?
Yeah.
What was that? When you first tried them on? How comfortable they are? Felt good on your penis?
No, I've never experienced that.
I have.
I know you have.
Thigh highs, though, not stockings. I'm not a queer.
No, it was the old show that used to come on after Monday Night Raw.
I swear to God, I thought it was a product.
No, yeah. No.
Well, remember there was USA Up All Night?
Yep, Rhonda Shear.
Rhonda Shear. I used to beat off to Rhonda Shear.
Well,
like
she
crazy.
Was a part
she's
of
disgusting.
One.
She's disgusting.
She mm-hmm. used to come into the WWF or WWE,
it was like
whatever
a cross
it was. Like,
yeah. USA, though.
And then they, Quantum Leap used to come on after some
who in
USA. I can't remember.
Who's that guy?
Didn't. No, what William Shatner did something. He did some kind of bad sci-fi show, like Tech War or something like that. Like, but it wasn't Quantum Leap.
Sam Beck?
Scott Bakula. Oh, Scott Bakula.
That's why his name. We're having him in, aren't we?
Are we having Scott Bakula in here? Why?
He said why? Yeah. I hope not.
Yeah, I guess.
Am I making it up, Travis?
I'll talk to him. Is Scott Bakula booked, Scott?
Didn't we
Travis?
Have him like months ago?
Oh, we did have him. Yeah. Right. Okay, I thought so.
You already interviewed him, and you were like, "Isn't he coming in one day?"
No,
yeah,
but then
that
we had him in.
Ago.
Okay, no, but I remembered something with Quantum Leap. Okay.
Let's go to Paul in Jersey. If you want to call, if you want to call the show, it's 866-969-1969. Louis J. Luis J. Gomez. And,
I like your respect to my culture.
Yes.
Luis J. Gomez is
and
here.
Dave Smith.
So is Dave Smith
from Legion of Skanks, not from the Bonfire, but from Legion of Skanks.
Big J
are both
took
here.
A powder. right now him and Damn Soder.
Damn Soder.
Yeah, they're massaging each other.
They're adults.
A couple of men.
He's moved weird. On.
Yeah, he's rubbing Jay's backside doing voices.
Paul in Jersey.
Yay.
Okay.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
What's up, buddy?
Hi, Paul.
Hey, Jim. You really have a lot of your old material, especially when you first started.
Yes.
I think that would make for a hell of a special on your website.
Do you know?
Just so people could see. Let me finish, because and I mean it's not 30. Just so how people can see how you've grown as a comedian and how much you've evolved.
I was so awful when I started. I don't have as much. I have a lot of my old sets from the Comedy Cellar from like 2000, 2001, 2002. I was looking recently for the right after 9/11 stuff.
Yeah.
That type of stuff I would be interested in seeing, but. I'm so much of my old stuff I didn't tape, unfortunately. There's no video of me when I was a kid. There's no...
But there's audio?
No. Just a couple photos.
Just nothing.
Nah, there's nothing, man. My family didn't have fucking any video equipment. I wish there was. But yeah, I could look for some of that. Someone, when I went to Cuba with Jeff Ross, we did the thing for the troops in Cuba. And some guy there said he had a videotape of me from like 1993 when I did something. And I saw it. I used to wear this shirt. On stage, you said, blah, 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 blah. It was like some weird phone company shirt that I thought was the coolest thing ever.
Was it?
No, it wasn't.
Oh.
And 1993, that was from. I was awful.
You were doing stand-up in 93 already?
I started in 1990.
Oh, wow, I didn't know you were doing that
so
long.
So you have a video of you in 93?
Yes. Well, that was the one when we did the famous in 2002. We were roasting each other on Opie and Anthony. We roasted my stuff. It was Patrice, Colin, Voss. It might have been Mercurio or somebody else that ripped me apart, and then we did Voss's old tape, and Patrice never brought his in, I don't think. So we would roast each other.
It was just always great?
Yeah.
Patricius was
always
like...
Oh, no, he was shitty. When he started, he wasn't as shitty as I was, but he was not good. And he thought he was good, which was very funny.
He's right. You could probably sell that on your website. Just sell...
It was so... Dude, it's so humiliating.
Yeah.
It was me in 93 at Rascals in New Jersey, and this other one was from some place in North Jersey, like Hackensack. Same material, but I was like, how we doing? I was like, all happy-go-lucky. It's repulsive.
Yeah, nothing's gonna... Even if I'm sure the caller's right, like, there are probably fans of yours who know your stuff very well that would love to see your older stuff, but I'd imagine from your perspective, like, no comics are so critical of their own stuff, especially your old stuff that's, like, you know, decade.
We did that on Legion of Skanks. We brought in our old tapes, and Dave, I mean... Watching Dave Smith in his first like 2 months of comedy.
Not good.
Oh, there's a it's a tape of me about I think a month or 2 months in comedy and it's having a bad set. So I mean it's going bad and me not prepared to deal with it.
Feign confidence. Like he was broken within a minute of the set. Like just slowly pitter-pattering through his jokes to the end. It was so uncomfortable.
I have the oldest tape I have, and I've never gotten the whole tape, unfortunately. It was a set I did in Rascals West Orange for the Bud Light comedy competition. And I was 21, and it was a April. I want to say it was I was doing comedy 6 months, and it was me. And I used to just leave the mic in the stand, and I kind of talk like, "Hey, how you doing?" Like, oh, it was so.
You would put voices on?
Not necessarily. You didn't know who you were yet.
it wasn't voices. Guido.
Yeah, in a way. Oh my God, I can't listen to this. But that's what that was.
We could listen to it.
No,
man, I would love to hear it.
I'll listen to 1 second.
Or you want to do the Jennifer Aniston?
That's the whole bit.
Oh, yeah. That's from 2010.
Yeah. Find a nice clip of one of Jim's jokes.
Because I think when you first start, at least I know I did, a lot of people, when they first start stand-up, you almost have this feeling of like, well, what would a comedian sound like? Mm-hmm. You know, like even if you have a funny idea, you're like, well, how would a comedian tell this? And eventually you realize like you can just talk.
I'm just getting out of that habit. Like I finally stopped, after 26 years, I finally stopped going, hey-o!
But it's so funny because comedy is like the only thing where it's like, it's the only thing where you start off being completely exposed when you fucking suck. Like if you're a professional actor, a dancer, anything else in the world, you're not going to be exposed to an audience until you're ready. Comedy is the opposite. Day one, you can do open mics, I guess, but honestly, you start to jump in on regular shows very quickly, and you have to crawl out of a hole of fucking sucking. Everyone has to crawl out of this hole of sucking, and it's this weird thing. It's surprising that there's this many people that actually want to do it, considering how much it sucks in the beginning.
Well, a lot of people drop off, though, in the beginning.
Yes, they do.
Like, most people don't hang through that stage of sucking because they don't realize that stage exists. Like, they're watching Netflix, you know what I mean, and being like, yeah, I could do that.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean?
And that's they get on and they try it, and they're like, ugh.
Yeah, this is terrible.
Do you, like, when I think of the people I started with, like, some of them are dead, but most of them just dropped out. Like, they just stopped after 5 years, and then after 10 years,
that's
or 12
brutal.
Years.
To stop after that long?
Dude, so many of them quit.
Well, your whole life is stand-up. Your whole social circle. Like, I'm not friends with anybody. I mean, I'm friendly with my old friends from high school and stuff, but I'm not friends with anybody who doesn't go through what I have like 4 or 5 friends. They're all comics. We all sit there on the phone talking shit about other comedians. We all talk shit about the business and how it sucks. And, you know, that's a thing that only... If I try to call my buddy who's working a fucking 50-hour work week, like in Parks and Recs and in Rockland County, and try to bitch to him about how... telling jokes isn't going the way that I want it to go, he would tell me to go fuck myself. We're not in the same thing.
Right.
We have a gang of comics that talk on the phone. We call it the 5 buckaroos. And we just get on the phone and we riff and we try bits. Me, Colin, and Bobby is the other 3. Not dude, I want to be a buckaroo, dude.
Dude, I do want to be a buckaroo. He's got 3 personalities. Dude, I don't know. Seems cool.
Yeah, we just talk, and then 5 buckaroos get on the phone and just riff. I'm like, what do you think about this? And I do my whole Trump voice, and they're really supportive.
Do you do a good Trump?
Oh, yeah, it's amazing.
Let me hear.
You're fired!
Oh, my God. That's like
I open it and
apprentice.
I close with it on the road.
That's terrific.
I open up like, guess who won the election? People are like, this guy's going to be good.
It's not just a good impression. It's what you do with it.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Crazy
it's
places
just different.
With it.
Yeah.
I look at a find a blonde in the audience. I'll be like, you look like Hillary. You're fired! Place goes
that's
crazy.
That's really funny.
This guy's good.
That's really funny. You're not going for the low-hanging fruit on that one.
No, not at all.
Trump comes back from the future as the Terminator to find a young Eddie Furlong. Go.
Oh, look at you, Eddie. I'm back and you're fired.
That's so good. That's so...
Told you I'd be back. Right. Not nice. New York Times is fired.
Yeah. It's good because he's still doing the fired thing.
Yeah.
That's still a topic.
Well, that's
around.
The core. That's the core. You build around.
I have the audience yell out things and then Trump just pops up. They go, people are bananas.
That's important.
They go bananas. Fucking go crazy.
I like that, Lewis, like you couldn't leave, like if you had that moment where like some people after 10 or 12 years just quit stand-up, like you couldn't do that because everything feeds itself, so you would have to decide to quit...
Life. I'd have to kill myself.
Everything. You'd have to quit comedy and quit radio and quit podcasting and quit running a podcast network.
And break up with your girlfriend because you can't date someone who's doing comedy if you just quit. It's too painful.
Yeah.
Yeah, you probably won't be able to take care of your kid anymore. You're going to have to get rid of him. I just want to peel other things away from your life.
She's going to have to start fucking me in the ass.
What do you mean start? That's rule number one when you get involved with Jim Norton. You see that belt? Put it on, bitch!
Shit. Yeah, I thought about that. If I quit comedy, I would literally have
disappoint
to...
eight people.
I would be, you know, if you ever watch Better Call Saul, in like the opening scene of the first episode, like he's working at like a Cinnabon or a pretzel factory. Mm. That's what I would have to do. I have to grow a beard, go to like the Midwest somewhere, get a job in a mall, and just disappear.
And not even announce it. Just not show up for every podcast one day.
Do you ever like, I don't know if it's the same for you, like in radio, if you know people who have like quit or were aspiring to make an event, but for you, Jim, I'm curious, like, for me, it's almost like I feel very sad when if there's someone like I run into who like quit comedy, and this is just completely my own projection because they could leave and like find a happier life, but to me, it's just like, oh, dude, it's so tragic.
I had
especially if it's someone who's funny or talented at all who quit.
Not too long ago, I had lunch with somebody who I was like, we were kind of doing the same thing, and he left. And he kind of had this thing, like, when you leave, you forget how hard it was. And so it's been years. It's been 6 or 7 years. And, like, there was no sort of, like, I decided to leave, and I'm happier for it because I didn't have to put up with that for 6 or 7 years. He just sees now what 6 or 7 years has done. And you could just see it in his eyes and the way he talked. Like, it was, like, sad. Like, I didn't even want to be there because it's like, dude, like, I don't know what to tell you because there's no going back. Like, if you'd like, let me jump back into this, it's like, yeah, but you still need to make up all that time.
Well, they see the progress of somebody who didn't stop, so I feel sad for them,
me
and
too.
It makes me very grateful. Like, as much as I've bitched him, I'm really fucking grateful.
And it reminds
and you, feel
you
lucky you didn't quit. Thank you for not letting me quit.
It reminds you too where you're at because you can look at people because when you're in the position that you're in, you're constantly looking at people that are more successful than you, and you just think you've been stagnant.
Sure, that's everyone I know.
Right.
And then I think you nailed it when you said the thing, like, it's like the first few years, which technically speaking, you have the least in the first few years, but you're kind of inspired to be in it.
They're
it's
great.
Fun. You're young. You're a dreamer.
Plus,
it's
everything's
easy.
Possible.
What's difficult, you're like, oh, this could all work out.
Right.
What's difficult is those kind of middle years when people around you start getting stuff.
Right.
You've been in this for a while, and when people bail out of that, it's exactly like you said. You're like, man, that sucks, but you bailed out of the really shitty years.
Right.
And those are the ones you gotta put in. It's easy to look at anybody. I mean, there's a few people who just take off right away, but pretty much everybody who's got a really great career in radio or comedy went through a really tough time. Yeah. Usually they grind it.
It's the exception to the rule if you take off in a few years. People look at people like Pete Davidson or Michael Che who got fairly, you know, I don't want to say easy paths because they're talented dudes, but they didn't have the same type of trials and tribulations that most successful comics have. Most successful comics put in 10, 15, 20 years of fucking hell.
Before they make a dollar!
But the best advice I ever got was just keep showing up. That was the best advice I ever got in comedy. Just whenever you feel like shit and you feel like you want to quit, you don't want to show up, just fucking go to a show. Show up at a comedy club. Go do your thing. And it was by Joey Gay, who I think quit. But I haven't seen him around in a while. But it really was some of the best advice ever because me and Dave talk all the time. You'll have like, you know, now it's gotten a lot easier as you start getting a certain amount of success. But you go through years of fuck, dude, I'm doing this for, is this a hobby? What the hell am I doing? And you have to just show up. No matter what you're feeling, just show
like,
up.
But it's also really good when you start putting in more and more of those really shitty years, you see the people. Because, like, when you're, like, in your, like, early 20s or whatever, like, when I was in my early and mid-20s, that's when I started seeing other people succeed quick. yeah. real quick.
He's watching other dudes just stacking up VHSs. Like, you're like, dude, I can do this better than anyone.
I'm sitting there, I'm hitting record. I don't. You can't record faster than I'm recording. How's he doing it?
He's got help. He's got two TVs.
It's considered cheating in the VHS yeah. sales community.
His girlfriend is hitting pause. He didn't have the goddamn commercial. Yeah. He's saving VHS space.
Well, of course, his dad's going to buy him three VCRs.
Yeah. Piece of shit, he's buying his tapes.
Sam in the open mic. Yeah. In the open mic's a VHS
bootleg.
Yeah, like an officer and a gentleman, you realize he's hiring someone to polish the shoes. You're like, oh, you piece of garbage. Oh, Mayo.
You got to understand, back then it wasn't about the money. It was just the love of VHS recording.
Right.
And then...
Well,
yeah,
you
got to
show
things.
Up, though. It's like at the end of every five buckaroos call, we say buckaroos.
Shut up about these buckaroos.
The only way to be in it is to win it is to be in it. And that's the way the five buckaroos, we all say that and hang up.
But what I was going to say.
I forgot Bobby was three of them.
We only got two buckaroos.
Yeah, of course. Of course. It's the five buckaroos.
Yeah, we're just swapping joke ideas and stories and tales of the road. Hey, Kyle, how was Syracuse? And he'll tell a funny upstate story, and I'll say, why don't you incorporate that into your routine?
Bobby, smart. You should record, or Jimmy, you should record those calls and put them on your album as bonus special.
That would be great. Yeah, yeah. The five That's buckaroos it. Riffing.
Right.
We'll make each other laugh. That's what we do. We're very
you guys
supportive.
Were doing podcasting before it was podcasting.
Absolutely.
Yeah, for each other.
Sure.
But the thing that helps is when you start seeing people that got successful early start to fail. And then you're like, oh,
that's
so
a real interesting one.
So I could have gotten it quick, but it's just starting here and it would have been over already.
Yeah, there were a lot of guys like that who, so like when I started comedy, were maybe like the guys who were past at all the clubs who we would really look up to. And then when the internet thing kind of exploded and getting your own fans and like podcasts, and none of that stuff really existed when we started.
Yeah. Dane had a lot to do with that. Dane was like the first guy.
He was the first guy who blew up off that stuff.
Yeah.
And then everybody started imitating it. But now it's weird. There will be guys like that who were like, you know, the first couple of years in, I was looking up to like, this guy's incredible. And that you look at those guys now, I'm like, they're not doing anything. And,
right.
And younger guys have, you know, the guys like Pete Davidson, who was like a kid, is now, you know, just levels.
Because it's
them.
Like, it's like you still, like, no matter what level you're on, you still have to do the work. Like, you still just have to keep plugging. So it's like a Pete Davidson could, even though he's skyrocketed, could just keep plugging and be fine.
Well, that's why guys like Attell and Colin and those guys are so, like, we all have so much respect for them because they all, like, grew with the times. Like,
yes.
All those guys could have at any point just stopped and been kind of like, oh, okay. And you'll still see, like, Attell working out some new bit about some new music video that's out today. And right. You know, he just, you know, keeps growing with the new generation.
Right. Well, we call it, that's what we refer to that as the pyramid of jocularity. As far as people who
calls it that?
The buckaroos.
Buckaroos, obviously.
Yeah, the pyramid.
What do you mean who?
Silly question.
The pyramid of jocularity. As far as rising and boom, boom, and the cream rising. It's cream rise to the top. We say that a lot.
Oh, that's so, I haven't even heard that before.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I guess
yeah.
When you think of a beverage, I guess, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's really
and
interesting.
And if somebody falls, like what one of the buckaroos will say is, well, looks like the pyramid was turned upside down, and we know what that means.
Wow, you don't even have to explain it to
no,
each other?
No, we understand so cool. That.
Wasn't it the buckaroos said it's not about how many times you fall, it's about how many times you get back up?
No.
Stupid.
That's not even close to true.
We never said that.
No.
Exactly.
No.
Not at all.
No. Are you upset that that you guys at the Legion of Skanks don't have that kind of buckaroo camaraderie where you're helping each other the way these guys are?
Well, all I know is if the buckaroos were booked on Jim and Sam in the morning,
absolutely.
All five buckaroos
absolutely.
Would be there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Five buckaroos, three chairs. One a little bigger, but just three chairs.
Yeah. Oh, shit. I think the Legion of Skanks are breaking up.
You think so?
I think so.
Could be.
It's over.
Could be. It's all that fucking pretty girl at the prom, Dan Soder, who spoiled everything.
So, yeah. He's our Yoko.
He is, right?
He came in and, yep.
Spoiled everything. So when Dan Soder is on Legion of Skanks now, is it almost like you guys are like, I thought this was our show too.
We don't show up.
We'll have fun.
We'll just let them do the show.
At the beginning, I'll be like, do you guys need me to talk or you guys got this on your own? You guys
right.
Are just going to do a lot of voices.
Yeah. No, yes, just take it. And you're like, okay,
fine. It's just kind of like watching the bonfire, except you're the kindling. ties in nicely.
It ties up. It's very insulting. You know,
I don't mean it like that.
You can't start a bonfire without kindling.
That's true.
Sam, why don't you look at the glass of being half full?
But you ever?
True, it's cum. He wants it to be totally full.
A full glass of cum.
Yeah, that's a lot of cum.
That's got to be more than one guy's cum.
I guess so.
Yeah, it would take months.
Yeah, sure. No, not if there's only a few guys. Maybe some might have a little yellow tint.
Oh, by the way, this happened yesterday morning. I was jerking off. Yes. And I got way too into it, so I started going like, ooh, like making it like a, like really, what? Like really get into the fantasy.
Was anybody with you?
No, I was by myself.
Okay.
And when I shot my load, it shot directly into the hole of my mouth.
Really?
Awesome.
Did
you swallow?
Imagine you didn't have a balloon in your nose.
I know, exactly. If there's a balloon in my head, it would pop.
Lewis was making an ooh, like he's like
it's a carnival game with you. Yeah.
Everybody wins.
It was the worst. And no, I didn't swallow it. I started spitting on my own chest.
Yeah.
Because
The problem with cum, and what I've heard,
tell him,
is that it makes you do that a lot.
Is that right?
Yeah. I've heard. For some people.
Yeah?
Yep.
Oh, I see.
Be a problem.
Yeah. I see.
Sorry to side note that, but it just reminded me.
So you spit it on your chest?
I spit it on my own chest.
Why are you going, ooh?
Because I got into the fantasy. You know, we were just like,
what was the fantasy?
I was watching porn, but you know how can you kind of go like, ooh, baby, yeah.
I just picture Lewis as like two faces. Like, remember Saddam Hussein on South Park? Like, it's just normal, and then ooh. And then he hit the jizz on the
just
ooh
a photo, show. And then it just changes.
Yeah, ooh.
Were you naked?
Yeah, I was naked.
So you were nude, and just really, you were feeling yourself.
I was jerking off.
Yeah.
Because, well, when I come onto my stomach and chest.
Absolutely.
Like, that's the way I shoot it. A lot of guys don't do that.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I don't know how to, like, they shoot at their legs, they get it on their bed. I don't know what the whole...
I had a video of myself one time. A girl wanted to see me come, so I have a black face towel that I put on my stomach, and I just gave a black face towel? A black
just to wipe off his black face.
Yeah, I got it from aljolson.com. I got the Ted Danson Christmas special.
This bit will never get old. Huh?
No, it's just it was a black towel, and because I wanted a nice contrast, and I just blurted some cum onto it. It's a really lazy cum.
Thing on your chest.
Yeah, my stomach, just for the contrast.
Sometimes, but I'll be honest with you. When I'm masturbating, I enjoy the fantasy. So I would never, in the fantasy of actually fucking, I would never put a towel on my stomach.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, right. I really get into, like, I'll grab the ass, like I'm doing a little air grab the ass.
Lewis's jerk-offs have to be believable. You're not selling it.
So you're miming. Like,
you're pantomiming?
I do. I pantomime make out with the air. We've talked about this plenty of times on Legion of Skanks. I'll kiss the air while I'm masturbating. Because I get into my fantasy.
Just fucking jerk off real quick and be done with
it. That's not just beating off into a sock. Like, how do you mentally get there? How can you even come?
You just watch some porn, you beat off.
And you're watching yourself beat off into a sock.
I don't look in the mirror.
Look in a mirror?
Me. It's the last thing I do.
I also can't come unless I'm looking in a mirror.
Is that right?
No.
No.
How do you guys even get into it if there's not a load in the mouth at the end?
That's a good point. That's a great point.
How did I not get hard again? That's the thing. It's a cycle. You just keep on coming in your mouth and getting hard.
Yeah, I like making smoochy sounds while I come. No, I'm dead silent. My fucking feet pointed out. It's disgusting.
Are you thrusting your pelvis as well?
Yeah, dude, I get into my masturbation. You're
air humping?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so strange.
Yeah, it's awful.
No.
It's like, why?
I feel like everybody is not masturbating properly.
No, you're the one who's doing it wrong.
I think that I'm progressive. I think I'm way ahead of the curve.
You're like a theater
here.
Student. Like,
I climb a rope and then I jerk off.
You're a mime. It's very
true.
Strange.
Yeah.
My jerk offs are quick and lazy and
I'm with you.
Yeah.
Do you lay on your back?
No, I just sit.
You just sit there?
I sit.
Where do you blow a load?
I tilt back.
Okay.
But it really, I don't have a lot of distance.
Do you watch porn?
Yeah, I watch porn. But I don't have a lot of distance, so it kind of just gurgles out.
Oh no, you come just kind of
like
fucking...
a volcano, like a
no, like The Exorcist when she's just slowly vomiting the pea soup out the side of the mouth.
It's like a sixth grade volcano science project.
Oh man,
you know what I mean? How it just kind of like at some point it just gurgles and then it just falls over the edges.
It's a little disappointing, just like that. It's like I expected a real badass volcano,
but there's no show to it whatsoever. You're just like, well, I guess it's cool that it's coming out.
But here's the thing. I think if I masturbated that way once I came, I would want to kill myself because I would feel so pathetic. If I make it a whole thing and I get into the fantasy and I really treat myself right, I feel like it's almost...
If it ended that way, you would want to kill yourself. Your story starts with it ending with you banging a load right in your mouth.
I know, that gives you what... That inspires you to live another day.
The fact that so much of your self-worth the fact that so much of your self-worth is wrapped up in masturbatory habits.
Well, we all masturbate every day. Stop acting like you don't. You masturbate just as much as I do, Sam.
I don't masturbate every day.
You're a liar.
Yeah, I don't
masturbate every day.
If I'm like regularly having sex with a chick, I'll masturbate much less than every day nowadays.
Yeah.
If I don't masturbate every day, and I have a girlfriend, if I don't masturbate every day, I will want to fuck nonstop. I have a crazy libido.
Like, you do.
Yeah, dude, we have fucked like in public. I fucked her on a cop car recently.
Is that right?
On top of a cop car.
On top of a cop car?
Yeah.
Like,
where
on the hood?
Was this?
In Gramercy at like 8 p.m. in the summer.
So it's still light out.
It was light out.
Wait, and there's just people all around and you fucked on top of a cop car?
No, we didn't. There was no people around at that point, but like it was very dangerous. And that got me going. So if I don't jerk off, I will have like crazy thoughts like that all the time.
Oh, I would never do the cop car thing. You're probably looking at like a serious charge.
Yeah, absolutely.
And how hot is that? How hot is that that we fucked on top of a cop car?
Not at all.
Was it quick?
I know. It was Adam 3. God damn it.
I wanted to joke on that. I still don't know what the joke meant.
I mean, there's a show called, it used to be Adam 12, so I was implying you have a small dick. So I said Adam
what year
3.
Was the show?
Wow. Old show.
Yeah. We'll be right back with WWF Raw. Yeah. So Adam 12.
Adam 12.
Adam 12, yeah.
You just sounded like an experienced comic talking to the young guys. Hey, you ever watch Adam 12? You got any jokes about that?
You don't remember Adam 12?
No.
No.
Travis?
No.
No.
Adam 12.
Come on, guys.
1968 to 1972.
It ended in 1972.
I just remember the show. I know. Wait, but the show, so what?
I
didn't watch My Favorite Martian, but I know it existed.
It was a 4-year-old show from the 70s.
Yeah, and it's very. Yeah, it's exactly. Not even like the famous one. Dragnet would have been the reference.
I understand Dragnet. I've heard of it. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Adam 12.
Hawaii 5-0. You could have said Hawaii 3-0.
Oh, wait a minute. Right. Go back. Adam 12 again. 68 to 75.
Now 7 years.
We're inching closer.
Yeah, to 75.
I was a boy. I was born in 68, for Pete's sake. Adam 12 would come on, I'd watch it like a boy.
None of us were born in 1975.
I know that. Hopefully you won't be alive in 2017.
Next year.
I know.
Adam fucking 3.
Yeah. Lady Trucker has a question actually for Louis J. Gomez.
What up, motherfucker?
Hey,
hello,
lady.
Madam.
Gentlemen.
Hey.
Hey, that'd be fatherfucker. Louis J. Gomez, do you take yourself on a date and light candles before you masturbate?
Do you light candles before you masturbate?
No, but there is a little more prep involved than like just grabbing my dick and starting to tug on it.
See, literally, like when I jerk off, it's like I'm doing something and somehow I stumble onto porn and be like, oh, I should just jerk off right now. I've got the 10 minutes or whatever it is. And then just jerk off, clean off in the bathroom. Back to what I was doing before.
Attaboy.
That's it.
That's easier. That's a better way to be.
It's much better.
I was jerking off last night. My dick wasn't even hard. Like, what am I doing?
There's no reason
for it. I know.
Why didn't you try to develop a hobby for yourself?
Anything. Anything would be healthier.
Yeah.
If I was eating thumbtacks, that'd be healthier than my jerk-off habits.
You know what you should start doing? Recording wrestling TV off of with the VCR tapes.
Dude, it couldn't be any worse than what I'm doing. I'm literally jerking off. My dick is just, it's like abuse, and I'm not horny.
Some Why are you doing it?
Exactly.
That's it. Just compulsion.
I stopped. A girl asked me, she wanted me to send my picture with my dick hard, but I couldn't get my dick hard because I wasn't horny.
Oh, yeah.
I was putting fucking weather stripping on my windows.
Ugh,
I had
to
send her a picture of my weather stripping. She said,
I never have as much trouble keeping a boner as when a girl asks for a dick pic. And you just feel that pressure that it's got to be like maximum boner.
The best
and
boner.
Take it.
Yeah.
And every time I feel like it's just, I can never keep it at good for, I don't know.
No, whenever.
I just get one off the internet, Senator. She doesn't fucking know.
She
doesn't
know. They have no idea.
How would she know?
It's black.
I have older. I feel like I'm lying.
Just three of them next to each other.
When a girl says, send me your dick now, I feel guilty that there's a timestamp in there that they can find. Oh, that's from last year. It's the same dick.
Oh, is there a timestamp on photos?
I know, but there can be in some of them. I don't know.
So you
panic.
Take new photos every time?
A lot I do.
You should just have one photo.
I have a bunch.
Let me say, Jim, can I see some?
What do you want to send one to the same fucking, send one to the same girl?
I guess because the girls need more and more and more.
Yeah.
What are they collecting?
Yeah.
I feel like half the time they don't even want it. They just want, if they want to send you one, they want to have one of you too.
A little collateral.
Like,
yeah. Yeah. But Jim's got like a fucking cell phone full of them, so it's terrible collateral. It's valueless.
Yeah, I don't. Even that game, it kind of just bores me. It's like I'll try to get nude pictures from girls. I'll always be asking for a nude picture. And the amount of time that the transactions take to convince her and fucking she's asking you for one and don't show your friends, I've jerked off 3 times to porn already.
Right.
Like, if I'm horny in that moment, I'm not going to fucking play this tease game. I'm at home alone. I want to jerk off, you know?
Plus, I hate the whole having to convince thing. Like, I like the idea. It just pops up because she wants to so badly.
No, it kind of turns me on a little bit to have to.
Have to convince. Have to
a lot of them are afraid of it living on the internet. That's all. They're afraid that it's going to, you know, come back to haunt them. Or there's always a little, but I don't like begging for it either, man. I'm just like, if you don't want to send it, don't.
Right.
Don't.
I like that somebody wants to.
No, I like literally when a girl gives me her phone. Let's say, like, this is a game we used to play all the time. I don't know if this is even illegal, but we'll ask them for their phone. We're like, oh, yeah, my phone's it. Can I use your phone? And then immediately you just go through all their naked photos and then email them to yourself.
What is she? How dumb is the girl?
We used to play this game called Hold Her Down While She Screams Now. And I don't know. Technically speaking, it might have been outside the law.
That's a party game.
That has the moral. Your party game has the moral integrity of your entrepreneurial spirit.
Yeah.
Like, you're a terrible person.
How do you do that? But how do you do it when you're supposed to be on the phone and you're pressing buttons?
Dude, I did that.
It's a horrible invasion.
No, you got to pretend to be sending a text.
You'll be hanging out. She'll start talking to your buddies. She's fucking turns around. I did this one time with an Asian girl at a bar. I sent the naked picture to myself. And by the way, she knew what was going on. She saw me looking at her naked pictures, right?
So she liked it a little.
So she liked it a little. It's a game. You let her know. Once you get the naked pictures, you show them that that's what you're doing, and then it's a flirty thing.
Can I tell you, by the way, I play this game except without the creepy part where Lewis sends them to himself, but I will do this.
What's the point of using mental image, Dave?
Right.
It's just a funny thing to, like, if you literally, like I'll do it sometimes, like, in front of the girl. I'll be like, okay, see your phone for a second, and then right away just hit photos. And I'll tell you, it is amazing the percentage of women who, if you hit photos, are just naked pictures.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's like,
really?
80% shot.
I played that game with my family. Ma, you got to make a call?
Hey, Mom, let me just see your phone real quick.
Oh, it's awful.
One of our interns had a cousin who was a prostitute in the Dominican Republic, and she was hot. And I was like, let me see a photo. And so this idiot doesn't have photos on his phone, so he gives me his phone with a Facebook album. So every photo, it's his cousin. I just started going through all of them, writing comments like, so sexy, so fucking hot, liking everything. God damn, I want to fuck you. Like,
which one? Who is this?
Hot dog.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What did you do? Started getting messages back immediately. But that's not like, that's like a prank. Like, yours,
funny,
Lewis,
man,
is more like real close to sexual assault.
Yeah.
No,
it's just
inappropriate, wrong,
really inappropriate.
Well, no, you know they say what's the actress, the famous one who got her stuff released?
Jennifer.
Yes.
Jennifer Lawrence.
Edie McClure.
Yes. She hot pictures, by the way. But she
from
said
Adam 12.
No. She was supposed to be on Adam 12, but I couldn't improv there. I just stopped.
So good.
That was a period in the middle of my improv. Ta-da! The curtain just dropped on me.
That's a great reference for naked pictures, like Katie McClure.
Oh, yeah. Shit.
Yeah, well, she said it should be a crime.
No, she said, I'm the victim of sexual assault, of a sex crime.
She's not. It's more robbery.
Yeah, exactly. It's a weird thing to say you're a victim of a sex crime.
Really, but it's not even robbery. I mean, is it robbery?
That's a real invasion,
man. It's an invasion.
Real invasion.
You're stealing our photos.
Did you guys,
I think it's literally the same
photos?
I don't know if I've seen. Somebody sent me some of them, but no, I didn't see most of them, to be honest. The ones I did see were sent to me, and I'm not saying that like as to like admonish, wash myself, but it's just scummy to go in there and steal somebody's shit like that. It's terrible.
Well, look
oh
at
no,
the,
I agree.
Look
I think
the big screen because they're up there.
It's the same thing as like breaking into someone's office and stealing their files or something like that. It's like the same shit, basically.
Yeah. But, really personal.
Except I can't jerk off to their files.
Can you though?
Oh, maybe.
She's great though. Look at
the Pete Townsend file you could.
But like, she's got more out of this deal than she lost because I'm a fan of hers now. There, people were kind of like,
are you going to see her movies?
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, I bet you're.
I'm a member of the Jennifer Lawrence fan club.
I'm a fan of hers now, which means you Google image her and jerk off. Like, oh, people, yeah, I'm so glad. Do you know I wasn't jerking off to you before the fappening?
People were lukewarm on Jennifer Lawrence before the fappening, and now all of a sudden, Everyone's talking about her. She's a household name.
She wasn't she an Oscar winner before that?
Yeah, she won for Silver Linings.
She wasn't doing nothing.
She's in three David O. Russell movies
every
in a row.
Every time I'm trying to make a point, here comes Jim with his facts.
Yeah,
I don't need it.
She's in the movie Joy, and it was just her on the poster.
But don't you feel like after she won that Oscar, she was like, "I've achieved a lot, but I don't feel like Louis J. Gomez is jerking off to me."
That's right. No, I can't jerk off to these movie posters.
She won the Oscar, and then she took the old Timothy Hutton route right down the fucking toilet.
Look at her.
Remember Timothy Hutton?
No.
I want to be with the
reference. God damn all of you. He won for Ordinary People. He beat out Pesci and fucking Raging Bull. Probably deservedly
so.
But
also the fapping, it actually desensitized everyone to naked celebrity pictures. I don't even care anymore.
I do.
So that thing, here's the thing. You know, like with Batman, where they had to say Batman killed the mayor or whatever the fuck it was, remember? That was part of the plot for the good of Gotham.
Yes, it's not the hero that you want. It's the one you deserve, whatever it is. Yes, I know exactly.
This is what the happening is. We needed this in order to get everyone desensitized to naked celebrity photos, and now we can all walk through life not giving a fuck about
it. Well, this wasn't even Batman that released all these nude photos.
Was it?
It was the Joker.
Wait. The Joker is responsible for the fapping?
That's right. I'll read your photo.
Boy, Joker really dried up the room.
Yeah. Travis, comment.
The second he said Batman, I knew it was going to be in your head. So bad.
Because he's not the hero, you know.
Yeah.
He's the Joker's more
That's not her.
Oh, the Joker's more of a villain than a hero.
Yeah. But there's also, there's other pictures. She was already so famous, but...
No, she wasn't famous. She wasn't famous until the fapping happened. That's but this, this,
it broke her.
There was
that's
another one.
That,
how no, come nobody's talking about the photos that came out last week? Nobody gives a shit.
Wait. Which photos came out
there
last
was a
week?
Whole. It was about 60 photos released.
Adrian, look these up.
Of Yaphet Kotto, and he was opening his asshole at the camera.
Nobody's talking about them.
No one's talking about them. But he had his fingers dug into his own asshole, and he was opening them at the camera.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
In a moment of free-spirited laughter.
Is this what the five buckaroos talk about?
No, we haven't even talked since then.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Colin was promoting his Netflix special.
It's got to be rough.
Yeah.
It's got to be rough.
Yeah. Fucking buckaroos.
Is that what he says? So stupid. What are you guys doing for Thanksgiving? You seen family? Do you have families?
Yeah, my family's in New York.
Yeah.
So I hang out with them.
Do you have an okay relationship with them?
Yeah. I mean, I have with the ones I'm going to see on Thanksgiving.
Right.
The other ones, not so much. But yeah, I'm like, I have a small family, but we're close. Like
do y'all talk politics? I would imagine that you're not a pleasant person to have Thanksgiving with because you talk politics a lot, and it's...
Annoying.
It's a, well, you have your opinions.
Unlikable.
Right.
Well, I haven't brought it up here yet. No, like, my sister's really into politics, too, but we don't really talk
She's
about
She's also very,
much.
Like, feminist liberal, too, right?
Yeah,
she's
that'd
very
be a
on
problem.
The other side. Yeah. Yeah, but we can, like, you know, we'll talk about it sometimes. It's fine.
Yeah.
I don't like to, like, we don't, that's not, like, what I spend the whole Thanksgiving doing.
Right.
I'm more fun than
They're
that,
Jews.
Sam.
They just count gold coins at the table.
That's cool.
You can't waste time on politics. You got these gold coins.
Order Chinese food. Yeah, they don't even have turkey. It's awful.
Do you have raisins in the stuffing?
No. I don't hate even bother that. With the answering.
Why? I hate that. Do you like your cranberry sauce to mix in with the mashed potatoes? Or do you not? I don't like it. I like a separate thing for each.
Nobody cares.
Can't wait to go to the... Probably go to my sister's. The Nortons have very small portions of food.
Why?
I don't know. The Norton portions have always been rather small, unpleasant little portions.
Because they're shaped like birds.
Roberts give heaping helpings.
They sure do.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, the Roberts aren't shy.
Sam's mother's a great...
Sam's mother's just throwing turkey and stuffing onto a fucking VHS. We need to get rid of these.
We don't have room for the plates anymore.
His mother's cookies are the best.
Don't worry about the cookies.
They're good.
They're fine. And we should...
Is that a pussy joke?
No, she's a good baker. She makes...
Nobody's asking you about them.
Well, I'm saying it's not about her pussy.
No, I know that, but nobody's asking you to further on the cookies. They're like, okay, we'll accept that fact.
What his
we'll
mother
move
does with the cookies
nobody's asked.
Is that in each cookie,
nobody's
she puts one of her gray pubes, and it acts like a handle for the cookie, it's a gray pube that she tears out from the root, and she bakes into the cookie, and you can pick it up like
out,
that.
It sticks out the
top.
Yeah,
then you pick it up, and you spin the cookie like a top, and you eat it.
Can I tell you something?
The cookie, and then the cookie smells like in between your toes.
Can I tell you something? My poor mother invited Jim to our Thanksgiving.
Exactly. She wants me to eat what they call a fucking a CHC.
What's a CHC?
It's a Conair cookie.
Okay, that's not.
I don't want one.
I've never had that before Thanksgiving. Do you do Thanksgiving, Lewis?
Yeah, I'm gonna go up to my my aunt, my great aunt,
mm-hmm.
And have Thanksgiving with the baby. Or not the baby. He's four now. But
where does she live?
Up in Rockland County. If you guys are familiar with Levity Live.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Palisades.
I've middled there many times.
I used to work at the Palisades Center Mall in high school.
Oh, I think we've talked about this before.
On a hot topic, yeah.
Yeah, you were not a great employee, right?
No, I'm terrible.
Right. I think I remember us talking
about
this.
I'm going to need Saturday off to go rob my dead neighbor's house and sell all his stuff.
I have this undying entrepreneurial spirit. What I would do is shoplift from the Hot Topic and sell it. Yeah. Oh, wow. What a business plan.
I'm not even lying. We had a shop lifting like ring, me and my buddies in high school, where we would go to the mall and we would, the guy who owned the pizzeria near me would give us orders to like go pick up fucking sneakers, golf clubs, different things from Model Sporting Goods, and we would just walk out with so much shit and sell it to this guy, and he would like hawk it to all.
I love when your son in 2 years is like, Dad, can I have a bike? And you're like, son, you go ransack the dead neighbor's house and get a bike yourself.
Yeah. You start a dead old lady furniture stand and sell it yourself.
They had thrown the stuff out. Okay, can we make this clear? We didn't go and like into the house and steal the stuff.
Travis used to work drive-through fast food and had an entrepreneurial spirit as well.
Did you really?
I don't know what you're talking about.
What'd you do in fast food?
I would maybe not ring up orders, but I memorized the prices in my head.
Same thing, of course. I worked at KFC.
You can't do that
anymore. That's a scam. If you're not doing that, you should be fucking fired. You are not a smart employee.
What, so, not taken from the register a
little
bit?
Yeah, you can't just steal 20, 30 bucks at a time. It's not a big deal.
So how does the scam work, Lewis?
Okay, so you're on drive-through, right? Like, yeah. You're working there long enough, so you know exactly how much a 16-piece extra crispy with mashed potatoes and coleslaw costs,
sure.
Right?
So with tax and everything, you know what the total is. It's the popular. It's the popular meal.
I like how Lewis just rattled that off. Like he's still got a little bit of that information.
Oh, it doesn't leave you.
I loved working at KFC. I'll be honest with you. That was also another moment in my life that was like that really taught me about like hard work. I was sweeping the floor at my KFC.
Sure.
And the owner came in and he was like, "Who asked you to sweep?" Like very angry. And I was like, "Oh, nobody. I just saw there was stuff on the floor." And he was like, "That's a perfect attitude. That's what we need." And he gave me a 50-cent raise on the spot right there.
Who's this boss? Like cocks a gun at you. Who told you to sweep? Well, that's why you get a 20.
Wow, that's the advantage of working at McDowell's.
He has his change belt like the old school train conductor. Ting, ting, ting,
yeah.
An extra 50 cents.
And then
you handed
your coin and you bit it. And you're like, "Aye, this looks good."
All right. No,
so
but,
you know how much the meals cost.
So you know how much the meals cost. So you say, all right, come up, you know, $23.75, come up to the thing. You literally just have the register open from the previous thing. You just don't actually close the register all the way. Give them their change. You pocket the money. Simple as that.
And they don't count the food or anything? or
not to that level. It's not a fucking science, Sam.
Right.
I mean, they're missing 8 pieces of chicken. You think they're noticing that?
I don't know.
Use your brain.
Okay, all right.
Now I used to work at a store. It was like
You got so fucking heated.
Yeah. But it's the same thing.
Use your fucking brain, bro.
Use your head for something other than a hat rack. My father would say.
It's a great
my head
dad.
A hat rack. Be a help, not a hindrance.
That's what your dad would say.
Yes.
Were you more likely a help or more likely a
hindrance? I was always being a hindrance. Yes, I was. Travis, what food place do you work at?
I worked at Burger King.
Okay.
Yeah.
What were you going to say, Dave?
I don't know.
You used to do the same thing, stealing.
Oh, yeah, steal. Yeah, but yes, if you don't log it into the register, you could take as much as you want.
Yeah.
And I got caught once by a customer who realized I didn't log it in.
How?
And like just knew what I was doing.
What a fucking narc.
Yeah. But she goes, "Did you not enter that?" And I go, "Oh, I'm about to."
Did you end up?
And then I entered it. I was like, yeah.
Well, you have to in case they work for the,
right,
the
they
Consumer
could be a,
Board of Protection.
What if they're a smart shopper?
Yeah.
You know, those fucking undercover.
Yeah. I used to nail my smart shopper tests because I could recognize the smart shopper.
How?
Because they weren't fans of the food. They would come up and then they would always order like a very specific type of thing. So they'd order like a, you know, a 2-piece meal, whatever. And they have to order certain things. So they have to order the coleslaw because they have to test the temperature. They have to order the mashed potatoes because they have to test the temperature. But they would do it in a very particular way, like they were reading the order off a piece of paper. So it was a very specific way.
Do you ever get just like a regular customer ordering that and you're like, oh yeah, sure.
Well, they probably got good service. They get the best service.
The worst thing that could happen is you give a customer good service instead of normally like you fucking jerk off into their mashed potatoes.
I pretend I'm a smart shopper.
You do?
That's why I get good service. Like, I'll walk in there with a pen, and I have a clipboard, and I go, I'd like a Big Mac, please. I check the clipboard.
With a French fries medium sized.
Yeah. Oh, I see. That's a smile. Thanks.
That's right. Thank you, Derek. I would like some French fried potatoes.
You pull out a thermometer.
Yeah. It's behind your ear.
Yes.
So you're saying if somebody comes in and just goes like, I want a popcorn chicken and a Coke, you're like, that's not a smart shopper.
No way, because they can't.
That's going in my
pocket. They have to test the temperature of these certain things. So they literally, you would. That's never a smart shopper. That guy, fuck you, buddy. You want a Coke, you throw it at his chest.
Yeah.
Yeah. Popcorn chicken, of course you do, homo.
I love popcorn chicken.
It's the best, isn't it?
It's really good.
Maybe you could add that to your cheat meal after your big special.
No, I'm going to have some pizza.
You are?
Yeah. Mm. And some pizza.
Mike.
Some cake balls.
Cake balls?
Yeah.
What's a cake ball?
Oh my god. It's where cakes go to dance. No, it's
fucking asshole.
Well, that was a stupid question. They're a delicious little treat.
A cake ball?
Please.
Use your head, Sam.
Yeah, exactly.
Sorry.
You know what a cake ball is, Travis?
Yeah, cake pops. It's on Starbucks.
Yeah.
Well, cake pop is different than a cake ball.
No, cake balls are different. They're amazing. Yeah, they look like they're gonna be awful munchkins.
It's just on a stick. It's the same thing.
Well, maybe, but I'm saying that I've never had them on a stick.
Why don't you just get a fucking piece of cake?
And they're amazing.
Because it's a little less than a piece of cake. It's a small cake. Plus, you can hold it on a stick and wave it at your friends. Yeah. I've got cake.
Cake is not testicle shaped.
No, that's true.
Exactly. I had to put a couple of cake balls under my nose.
Yeah.
I put onions on the cake balls.
You're sitting there like, why are you eating this stick of this cake pop? That's not how it works. Mike in Jersey.
Hey, Sam. So, Jimmy, you remember Rickle in Jersey?
I do.
All right, so what we used to do is before inventory control, we used to basically call up the customers after they'd buy these rugs, and we'd be like, hey, how's everything going with the rug? And they'd be happy and, you know, say, oh, everything's great, the coffee table, we're enjoying it. So then we would just write return slips and pocket the cash.
See, I had a guy... I worked at Sam Goody for a while.
Of course you did.
Yeah, nobody made that joke.
No, but I bet Sam at Sam Goody, right? They're probably, okay, this is your store.
That's what I was referencing, yes. But there was a guy, there was one kid in the whole store that was like a skate kid, you know? And this was when like Tony Hawk's Pro Skater was like the big video game and everything. And he ended up getting taken out of the mall in handcuffs. Because they realized there had been just a gross amount of returns over the course of not a lot of days, like 3 days or something. He couldn't have been lazier about it. And they started going through these return slips, and it was like Bucky Lasik, Tony Hawk. Like, it was all the most famous skateboarders in the world. That's how he had filled out the return slips.
They were shopping there?
No, Jim.
Oh.
And they were very easy.
He was just a dummy. The same way we would use our cat's names to sign up for Columbia House.
Right.
He would do his favorite skaters for return slips.
But like it's like there's only one kid who likes skateboarding. Yeah. And
nobody else knew who Bucky Lasik was.
Yeah, and Tony Hawk didn't stop by the store last time I checked.
Yeah.
So all they had to do was open the drawer and
he
got
Tony
fucking
Peralta
busted.
Returned $30. I used to go into the Modells. This was just an old, if you want $80, you could do this to this day, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah?
You just go into the Modells, grab a pair of rollerblades, bring it to the front, and say, I'm returning this. I forgot my receipt.
And it worked?
Yeah. I would do that all the time. Or what you do is you find receipts in the parking lot, and then whatever's on the receipt in the parking lot, you go into the mall and bring it to the counter.
Dude, Lewis is a wizard at this stuff. Okay?
When I was like my mom gave me that idea. She's like, oh yeah, go to the supermarket, find a receipt on the ground, return some chicken, you'll make some money.
Dude, I never have the balls for any of this. But right. I'm just too neurotic and Jewish. Lewis is fucking on cop cars. But Lewis used to, when we first met, me and Lewis were like 20 or something like that, and we were obsessed with MMA, and we used to go to the Virgin Mega Store to buy like Pride DVDs,
sure. UFC
somebody had DVDs. I don't remember whose joke it was, but it used to be a great one-liner joke. Is a stand-up. He goes, Virgin Megastore, false advertising. Anyway.
That's mine.
That's an old Norton. Yeah. I remember that. But we used to go in there, and Lewis had this scheme. It was pretty amazing, and he was so like dexterous that he could do it. But he would switch price tags. So he'd go get like a really cheap DVD's price tag, take it off, put it on the DVD we wanted, and we'd go get like a DVD for $3.
Yeah, right. My Little Pony DVD for $2, and then you get a $40 Pride box set.
So we got that My Little Pony DVD for only $2. And then we go back and watch
it. Yeah, because even if they scan it and it's a certain price, you're like, no, that price tag says $3. You can't, that's illegal.
And by the way, the letter of the law is that if there's a price tag on something, they have to sell it to you for that price.
You know, we would do the best scams when I worked in receiving and warehouses, and when boxes come, they like with stuff in them, they come with you packing peanuts. They're like, those little fucking styrofoam peanut things that pack a box. So what I would do is I would steal the packing peanuts. I would tie off the bottom of my pants with rubber bands, and I would fill my trousers with packing peanuts. And I'd go home with them.
And then you'd open up your trouser legs, and your dad would say, Jimmy, you're being a hindrance, not a help.
No, I would just save all the packing peanuts, so I always had them at my house.
Why would you need packing peanuts?
In case.
You really were a hindrance.
Yes, I was.
What a mess. What a mess.
Put them in my trousers.
We should take a break.
Yeah.
We've got Dave Smith and Louis J. Gomez here. Technically, they're on the Legion of Skanks podcast. But
not for long.
Yeah. Especially not after this beef that they were talking about with Big J, who would far prefer, he said, he would far prefer to do the Bonfire than Legion of Skanks. So. Yeah.
Well, obviously.
Right.
You know.
Can you hear it in his voice that he's having a better time doing that show than the show with you guys?
Oh, he's like a kid in a candy shop.
That's a bummer.
Yeah. Well, like Big J in a candy shop. It's the same type of joy.
That's a bummer. But you can still, for the time being, subscribe to Legion of Skanks, and you can get the Real Ass podcast, and you can get Part of the Problem.
And GasDigitalNetwork.com.
That's all on Gas Digital, right?
Everything's on GasDigitalNetwork.com. You get the shows 5 days before they come out on iTunes. You guys get the video version of the show, the archives beyond the past 10 episodes. We have a great chat room that goes while the shows are going live, so you can chat. There's a message board. Really great stuff. There's 11 shows on the network. We're growing constantly. We just added Bruce Buffer from the UFC, UFC ring announcer, plus Jamie Josta from Hatebreed. It's really a great network. If you use the promo code LOS, you get a 14-day free trial to see if you like the premium service. Yes. So try it out for free.
See if you like it, and you can follow Lewis at Lewis J. Gomez and Dave Smith at Comic Dave Smith.